We're starting a minute or two late. We've just come from another meeting. It is the council meeting for January 25th, 2016. I'm Mayor Ted Schaefer. And with me this evening are my council colleagues, Councillor Jack Arnold, Councillor Paul Albrecht, Councillor Rudy Storteboom, Councillor Gail Martin, and Councillor Val Vandenbroek. With us on the staff side is Darren Light, our Director of Corporate Services. We have Paula Cusack, Deputy Corporate Officer. Francis Chung, our CAO. We have Gerald Minchuk, Director of Development Services and Economic Development. Rick Baumhoff, Director of Engineering, Parks and Environment. And Kim Hilton, Director of Recreation, Culture and Community Services. So the first item is a call for the public hearing to order. And I have to read this for the legal part of it. The public hearing is convened pursuant to Section 464 of the Local Government Act in order to consider the following proposals. Bylaw number 2976, Zoning Amendment and Development Permit number 8-15. The purpose to amend the zoning bylaw 1996, number 2100, to add a new comprehensive development zone, CD41, to rezone the properties located at 20721 and 20725 Fraser Highway from RS1 single family residential zone to C1 downtown commercial zone to CD41 comprehensive development zone to accommodate a 21 unit townhouse development. Development permit DP08-15 applicable to the subject property will be considered to address building form and character. The applicant is Keystone Architecture. Second one we have is bylaw number 2978, Zoning Amendment and Development Permit 09-15. The purpose to amend the zoning bylaw 1996, number 2100, to rezone the properties located at 5290 and 5308 201 A Street from RS1 single family residential zone to RM3 multi residential high density zone to accommodate a 4-story, 70 unit condominium development. Development permit number DP09-15 applicable to the subject property will be considered to address building form and character. Applicant points West Architecture. At this public hearing, the public will be allowed to make representations to council and all persons present who believe that their interest in property is affected by the proposed bylaws and development permits shall be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard or to present written submissions respecting matters contained in the proposal. Those of you who wish to speak concerning the proposed bylaws and or development permits, commence your comments to council by clearly stating your name and address. Then you may give us the benefit of your views concerning the proposal. Members of council, if they may wish, they can ask questions of you following your presentations. However, the main function of council members this evening is to listen to the views of the public. It is not the function of council at this public hearing to debate the merits of the proposed bylaws or development permits with individual citizens. Everyone shall be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard at this meeting. No one will be or should feel discouraged or prevented from making his or her views heard. Any person who wishes to present a written submission to council may do so. All those submissions will be retained by the corporate officer and copies of submissions will be available from her upon request. So, the first one we have is Bylaw 2976, the zoning amendment bylaw for properties located at 20721 and 20725 Fraser Highway. To the corporate officer, how was this public hearing advertised?
Thank you, Mayor Schaefer. The public hearing was advertised by placing notices on the City Hall notice board on Tuesday, January 12th, and advertisements were placed in the January 14th and 21st issues of the Langley Advance.
Thank you. Now, I invite Keystone Architecture to present the proposal for Bylaw 2976 and Development Permit Number 08-15. Gentlemen.
We'll go over it with you right now. So the proposed project is a 21-unit townhouse development. It's made up of four separate three-story buildings. The proposed site is made up of two properties, kind of split right down the middle of the site, as well as a small portion of laneway that was purchased by our client off the city. There's an existing right-of-way that runs through the middle of the site here, kind of splitting it into two. So that, along with the narrow, elongated shape of the site, basically dictated our building layout with the roadway running down the middle of the site. There's only one access for vehicles and pedestrians into the site. It's off Fraser Highway, right down here. There's basically five unit layouts in this development. The areas of the units range from 1,350 square feet to approximately 1,520 square feet. The required parking for the development was two stalls per unit for tenants and five visitor stalls. We provide the two stalls per tenants in side-by-side garages in each unit, and we provide six visitor stalls over top of the right-of-way here in the central portion of the site. Garbage and recycling enclosure is located here at the back of the site, and we also provide 650 square feet of outdoor amenity space located here in the central portion next to the parking stalls. One of the concerns in this neighborhood is security, so we're proposing to erect a 6-foot-high wrought iron black fence along the entire portion of the west, north, and east property lines. That fence will turn back to the corners of the buildings along the south to fully enclose and secure the backyards of the buildings. There's existing trees along this portion of the west property line. All those trees will be retained. We're doing 100% tree retention in this development. This is just context plan showing the neighborhood surrounding our development. You can see the two properties here and here and the small portion of laneway that was purchased. There's a Catholic church directly across Fraser Highway to the south. Masonic Hall here directly to the west, and the north and the west, or the north and the east, are existing residential condo buildings. This is the first floor plan and second floor plan for Building A. For Building A and C, for the end units facing Fraser Highway, we located entries off the ends of the building. We're trying to create as much of a streetscape along that narrow frontage, so we located the entries and the covered decks and private sidewalks leading directly to the sidewalk on Fraser Highway. You can see the side-by-side garages for each of the units. The second floors for all the units is the living space. It's basically an open concept layout. This is the third floor plan and roof plan for Building A. Every unit is three bedrooms, and at least one bedroom in each unit has a Juliet balcony provided, just to give a little bit of extra private outdoor space. This is the first floor plan, second floor plan for Building B. And the third floor plan and roof plan for Building B. First floor plan and second floor plan for Building C. Again, you can see the end unit has the entry off the side with the covered deck. And third floor plan and roof plan for Building C. First floor plan and second floor plan for Building D. And the third floor plan and roof plan for Building D as well. The exterior elevations for Building A. The exterior materials include classic brick with varying profiles of hardy siding, including board and batten, hardy shingles, and horizontal lap siding. The elevations for Building B. The color scheme for the entire development is the same. It's a range of blues and grays with white trims. Exterior elevations for Building C. We were a little bit concerned with the narrow roadway creating a bit of a tunnel effect between the buildings, so we tried to incorporate roofs over the entryways and the garages just to break up that elevation, exterior elevation, give it more of a pedestrian feel. And exterior elevations for Building D. These are just a detail of our garbage enclosure at the back of the site there, so the materials and colors will be designed to match the buildings. Just a quick site section, the site's basically dead flat, so it's three-story townhouses on the flat site. So there's some 3D views from Fraser Highway. The one on top is looking towards the east, the one on the bottom is looking towards the west. This is a landscape plan that was prepared for us by Clark Cavallinus and Associates. You can see a image here of the proposed black wrought iron fence that's going to be surrounding the property. here's some SEPTED design principles that we incorporated into our design. Norm's going to go through those.
Okay, there's four basic principles. One is natural surveillance. We have large windows in each of these units, for the so-called eyes on the street. The landscaping and fences are all low, so you can see all areas from your unit. So the next one is natural access control. We only have one main access control, which is on the south in the center. So that semi-private, semi-public driveway, everybody can see out onto it. And there's no other way of basically getting on site other than this. Each unit has a patio in the back. That's for territoriality. Anyway, they have their own private patio, and the only people in the private patios would be the people living in those residences because they are fenced off. There will be a full maintenance plan and a landscape plan, so the buildings and the landscape will be well looked after. So we think this will be a pretty safe environment for this area.
That's it.
Thank you. To the corporate officer, Ms. Cusack, were there any speakers on this particular list?
No, Mayor Schaefer, there are no speakers, and there was no correspondence received for this item.
Thank you. Any questions from council? Councilor Vandenbroek?
You were talking about security and the gate all the way around, which is fantastic. I do have concerns, though. People from the the church and who hang around that area are probably going to try to cut through. They're going to get to your gate at the back, and then they're going to realize they can't go through. So is there any signage in the front that you're going to erect to identify that it's a private complex, that there's no way to get through? Because they're going to try to cut across, which they already do through the Masonic Hall there. So have you guys thought about that?
Yeah, we do have the mailbox building, basically. Yeah. The kiosk is going to be here at this front corner, so there's definitely opportunity to create some signage
And is that going to be inside, or is that going to be outside the mailbox? Is there actually going to be a housing for it so that you have to get a key to get inside the house to get inside the mail?
No.
Or are they open boxes?
They'd be open boxes. It's not a building where you enter and you get to the mailbox.
Okay, I have some concerns about that too. Okay, so is there going to be signage at the front of the complex?
Yes, we will incorporate some signage.
Okay.
We could also send out a letter to the church and advise them, that there is no shortcuts.
It's not just them. People do hang out in behind there, and then the Masonic. And I don't know if this is going to go to staff or not. The Masonic Hall parking. What's going on with that? Then seems like a very tight area to put in those townhouses, with the hall right beside it. So what's going on with the parking at the hall?
Mr. Minchuk.
Mr. Mayor, through to Councillor Vandenbroek, there is no proposed changes to the adjacent Masonic Hall property. They just recently resurfaced the parking lot, so the current configuration is intended to stay.
It's my understanding they just did some improvements to that building too by putting on a new roof and interior upgrades, so that building will be staying there for a while. Councillor Storteboom?
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor, and happy birthday to you. I did want to ask about that community mailbox. I'm very much concerned about the security of those boxes. I know where I live at Paddington Station. Our community mailbox has been out of order for 2 months, and we've been broken into four times this past year. So I don't see them as being as secure as maybe Canada Post would have us believe. Are there any special provisions being made to secure the mailboxes there? Because I'm afraid that if they're out in the open like that, they're just a target waiting to get hit.
Well, the location of the mailboxes are very visible from the unit, so there's going to be natural surveillance on it. We can definitely incorporate lighting, security lighting that comes on when people come there. I'm assuming a lot of that stuff happens at night, so some sensors on, lights on sensors that'll turn on when someone comes up to it in the dark, which would also help deter and scare people off.
Well, it wouldn't discourage me from supporting your proposal, but I would encourage you to investigate any other alternatives for the benefit of your buyers, because I'm sure that it's something some of those buyers will be considering as well. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Albrecht.
Yes, thank you. As chair of the advisory planning committee for this particular application, I just wanted to note that it was approved by the committee. We had a few concerns and questions, like has been identified earlier. We also noted try to put some pedestrian-friendly component to the inside for pedestrian traffic through. So the overhang or what have you might cover that off. It does meet the zoning requirements and does fit in to the neighborhood plan and the ROCP. I do have to note that I think they've done a good job trying to get something that's going to work with a very challenging, narrow site. And the servicing looks like it'll be good, so I look forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Martin.
Thank you. Getting back to the mailboxes, given that there's only 21 units there, is there a reason why it can't be door-to-door there?
Depend
on Canada Post.
Yeah.
I'm sorry?
It would depend on Canada Post. Uh-huh. We haven't been able to have individual mailboxes in any of our townhouses, but it's a really good question. I assume that Canada Post allow it.
Well, I ask because I live in a 24-unit townhouse complex, and we have door-to-door delivery. Mind you, it's an old one.
You're probably grandfathered, right? So,
okay. Well, you see, so what you're saying now is Canada Post saying is all new say townhouse complexes
I'm not 100% sure, but I think you're allowed one main street address for your post office box. You're not allowed a street address in unit one, unit two, unit three.
You're not allowed that.
I don't think so, but we can check on that.
And if it is allowed, then that's something that we'd definitely be willing to explore.
Yeah, I mean,
it makes sense, yeah.
I agree with the comments in regards to the mailbox, especially given the situation that you're in down there, or, you know, the location you're in down there. So it might be worth checking out.
Right,
thank you very much.
Thank you. Further? Seeing none, council will be dealing with this later. So. You're off the hook right now. The next item we have is pertaining to bylaw 2978, the zoning amendment bylaw for the properties located at 5290 and 5308-201A Street. Points West Architecture. Wes, welcome.
Thank you. How are we going to get to where we want to go? Almost there. Great. Can I go to that little button down there? This one? Yeah. All right. Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, Council, and our neighbors on.
Don't forget to keep the mic close to you.
Yes, thank you. Today we're presenting a 70-unit condominium at the corner of 53 Avenue and 201A Street. This site is in an area designated in the official community plan as high-density residential, and we're bringing you a proposal that conforms in all ways and requires no variance. This is our location at the corner of 53 and 201A. This is what our building will look like from 53. We've oriented the entry to this side. It's the main traffic street. So it has a two-story entry feature, as well as the handicapped access ramp, so everyone can get to the front door comfortably. And this is the view of the building from 201A Street. On our site plan, you'll see that we meet all of the setback requirements. We're 25 feet from all property lines with the residential building. As mentioned before, the pedestrian access is from 53A. And all the vehicle access will be down the existing lane. Of course, we'll be improving that lane with pavement and drainage to city standards. Our underground parking has two components, the first being the visitor stalls. They're separated from the resident parking with a security fence and a gate that will have fob access for the residents. There's also bicycle parking, workshop area, as well as the mechanical and electrical service spaces for the building. You can also note we have a large garbage and recycling room where the trucks can access directly from the lane, but the residents can access from securely from inside the underground. There's also a car wash bay in this area for convenience. And just to orient you, there is, this takes up most of the block, there is an existing fourplex at this location, just before 53A Avenue. Our first floor plan shows you the arrangements of the suites, as well as the majority of the amenity spaces, a large meeting room, an exercise room and a lounge adjacent to the lobby, a central elevator providing access to all the floors, emergency exits at either end, and a perimeter walkway. This will show up in the landscape plan as well. And it's a nice feature for the residents to walk around and also adds to the security of the building. Keeping eyes on the streets. Second floor and third and fourth, similar floor plan. All the units having decks on the exterior of the building. Very large courtyard area which incorporates most of our landscape features. We've provided a large road dedication. Along here is required by city's engineering and a corner cut. So we can improve the condition of the streets there. Roof plan, we do have a low slope roof on the building and some very nice vaulted gables that face out, inviting the light into the top floor suites. There is a flat roof over the entry in this area. Here's some of the suite plans. We have a variety of one and two bedroom units ranging from 450 to 930 square feet. So a nice range, definitely on the more affordable end, and nice layouts if you want to have a closer look. These are our elevations, east and west, west being a little more prominent. We did on the west elevation, following our meeting with design panel, we have articulated this wall to a greater degree, allowing some landscaping in front on our property. The north and south, south being the street again, the central entry, the two-story roof. Here's some of the gables, vaulted gables into the living rooms, providing that extra light up top. Our septed design has been reviewed by both Liahona Security and the RCMP in great detail, and we are sure to meet all of the requirements, including number one, natural surveillance The landscaping allows clear and unobstructed views. Open railings have been designed to allow surveillance in the street, both from the balconies and from the landscape podium. Number two, hierarchy of space. The raised podium defines the public and semi-public spaces. Decorative fencing separates semi-public and semi-private spaces. Number three, territoriality. We have large private decks on the ground floor to create a sense of ownership of the outdoor space. Number four, target hardening. Our exit doors, emergency exits, have no exterior hardware. And the exterior lights are vandal resistant. And number five, access control. Entrance lobby is well lit and overlooked by windows. There is a clear defined access that fronts onto 53 Avenue. Here's our exterior materials. We have a laminated asphalt shingle, higher quality, longer warranty, nicer profile. We have a variety of vinyl sidings, including the vertical at the base, horizontal in the middle, and vinyl shakes in the gables. We have cultured stone on our columns, black metal railings, and a number of heavy timber columns and beams on the exterior. Now we're into the landscape portion, and Meredith is the designer and here to describe that to you.
Good evening. My name is Meredith Mitchell with M2 Landscape Architecture. I'm both a landscape architect and an ISA certified arborist, if need be, to answer questions. One of the mandates for this particular project was ensuring as much pedestrian circulation pattern as much on the podium deck, which is what we thought was an important one, especially due to the septic concerns on the site. So we really wanted to focus on the circular path, essentially, that what we did get, which is nice. And we've created kind of a nice layering effect of public, semi-public, semi-private, and then private space that create both eyes on the street on the actual street frontage, but then also eyes on the street on the podium deck as well, but giving people patio spaces that are slightly separated to create ownership of their own yard space as well. On the 53rd Street frontage entry, we've also got a main entry, and then we do have some landscape areas, as Wes was noting, on the street frontage to create a sense of pedestrian level green space as well, because it is a slightly elevated podium deck, and we wanted to make sure that it felt green on the street frontage as well. A ramp entry and a stair entry that gives a dual entry purpose to the site for universal access. And then the actual pathway itself is totally universally accessible, as well as it's one level. And then there's layering of planting that creates a separate space of hedging in the actual patio and yard spaces of the individuals on the ground floor, which we're really hoping to allow people to really use their space. And then we created a tiered effect of different uses in the actual quite large amenity space that's in the east. We're going to get quite a lot of eastern morning light, which is nice, and we've got sort of a central core area of seating area. We've got separate smaller areas. We've got vegetable garden areas. We have an actual secure dog park as well, because we wanted to make sure that everybody nowadays, they have dogs and they have condos. And what are you going to do when you have a condo and a dog? You can't kick them outside anymore. You have to take them outside. So we have a secure dog park area, which we hope are really going to be used. And then we have some barbecue areas. And we really wanted to create this tiered space in the children's play area as well. So it really, I think, is going to be quite a utilized space, which is really nice to see. So generally, when it comes to SEPTED and security, this will allow for good views on all four sides, which is nice to see. And then also, because we actually separated the walkway in some areas to allow some green space against the parapet, we are going to try and get as much cascading green as possible coming on the actual four sides as well, to allow a little bit more green space even when it's zero lot line along the other edges of the site. So we do have hopes to have quite a bit of green space feel on all four sides. That's a general overview if you have any questions.
Thank you. To the corporate officer, Are there any speakers on your list?
Yes, sir. Mr. Mayor, I'd just like to add that there were two pieces of correspondence received regarding this development. One was opposed, and the other cited concern about increased traffic. The first speaker is Kelly Lowe.
Please take to the mic and make sure it's on.
Yep. Hi there. I didn't hear anything about parking. And we already have a traffic issue, which is my number one thing on our street. I live on 53rd, just about 10 doors down. And how many parking spots are there going to be? 99? Are they going to be underground, or are they all going to be on the street? Or?
Yes, all of the parking is provided underground, so it's secure.
And how many spots did you say?
I didn't say. Now I'm going to have to look it up.
Okay. Because this goes in with the traffic calming on 53rd, and with the city's two speed bumps, which I propose three, because if you have two speed bumps with this many more people driving up and down to get home to 53rd and 203rd, they're just going to slow down over the first bump, speed up to the second one, slow down, and then get home. So it's still a school zone. It's still a playground zone. So I really think that having this many extra vehicles, how many units? 70?
There are 70 units.
So let's say 100 more vehicles speeding down 53rd. You know how I am, right? So I would like to see an enhanced traffic calming because of this. And we won't even get into the traffic circle, which I don't, on 203rd, I do not agree with it. I don't know if the city's done a traffic count study as to 203rd and 53rd, how much traffic's actually going through there, how much more traffic is there going to be, and is a traffic circle mainly for a less busy intersection than that one? So that's all my comments.
But thank you. I'll ask staff to, discuss some of your traffic concerns there.
Yes, sorry. We did perform a traffic analysis last year, and based on the TAC pedestrian, so it's the Transportation Association of Canada pedestrian crossing control guide. I'll just note what we found. The average daily traffic at this location was extrapolated from a volume count to approximately 900 vehicles per day on a two-lane road. If there are less than 1,500 vehicles per day, there are adequate crossing opportunities at the intersection of 53rd and 201A as far as pedestrian crossings. The location does not warrant any crossing control devices. And there is a marked zebra crosswalk and pedestrian signs at the location on the west side of the intersection, and a hydro light is located over the crosswalk on the north end of the crosswalk. The south side of 53rd Avenue has parking removed on the approach to the crosswalk in the eastbound direction, and as part of the traffic calming on 53rd Avenue, there will be curb bulges installed on both ends of the marked crosswalk across 53rd. On the west side of the intersection, and it's suggested that a curb bulge, and it will be, is part of the requirements of this development to install a curb bulge on the northeast corner of the intersection as well. So that's in regards to traffic.
Mr. Lowe?
Your traffic study, was that done when people were on holidays in the summertime, or was that done during school back in session?
That was done during schools back in session.
Okay.
Yes.
Thanks.
Councillor Martin?
I just wanted to clarify, Mr. Baumhoff, you may have said this and I may not have heard you, but the crosswalk after the traffic calming is going to be a raised crosswalk, is it not? If I recall correctly?
I would need to confirm that.
That's what I recall.
Know. Okay.
So it's almost like a third speed bump, almost. But maybe you could email me tomorrow or
sure.
something. Thank
yeah.
you.
Thank you. Next speakers from the list.
Betty Coonan.
Thank you. Thank you, Council. My name is Betty Cunnan, and I live at 20111 53rd Avenue, so just outside the 100-meter zone where folks got a letter. I'm speaking to Council tonight because I'm concerned that the proposed 70 units on these two properties exceeds a reasonable density for our neighborhood. I'm also concerned, having hearing the landscape plan, that I'm not sure that the eyes in the street are going to be met from the circular pathway. I wonder about what aesthetic draws people out to walk around the perimeter of their building in that neighborhood. And given that the Nickelmacko floodplain is less than a block away, I wonder about the redundancy of a dog park in this situation. I went through my neighborhood and I did a soft poll communicating to over 50 of my neighbors, over 40 of which who answered the door. And of those people, 36 were either unaware of the high level of density that was being proposed for the neighborhood and had assumed that it was actually going to parallel the density that we've already experienced in our neighborhood. And four members of my community spoke in favor, including Councillor Martin. So on behalf of my neighbors, I really ask for this council to slow down and reconsider whether or not density, just for the sake of density, makes sense, or based on a 2,000% increase in traffic, whether we want to consider design objectives, including the consideration of the kind of neighborhoods that we're building in the city of Langley. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
So are there no questions from council on the 36 members of their community that are opposed to this?
No, we're just waiting for the, council.
I'm not sure you can answer for all of the people that you've spoken to, but you can answer for yourself. May I ask, how long have you lived there?
I moved into Langley in 2011, and I moved into what I consider to be a neighborhood. Many of the people who I spoke to also who've moved into recently had no idea about the proposed community plan and assumed that zoning preempted over a proposed idea that was initially established in 2005.
I understand. That's unfortunate. May I ask our Director of Planning and Development, how long has the area been in the official community plan for multifamily residential?
Mr. Mayor, through to Councilor Storter-Boone, although our current official community plan is dated 2005, the densification study that was completed for the city of Langley dated back to the late 1990s, when various density distribution patterns, including this area, was designated as high density residential in the community plan. So it's been probably 5 years before, 5 or 6 years before the 2005 OCP, that this area has been designated multifamily high density residential.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Albrecht?
Yeah, I was just going to ask staff if how does this compare with other buildings that have been developed in the same general area?
Mr. Mayor, through to Councilor Albrecht. In most cases, not in all cases, in most cases, developers seek to maximize the density permitted in various areas throughout the city of Langley. We have, however, on occasion received applications, most recently along 55A Avenue, that sought rezoning for far less density, townhouse density, in areas that would be designated for higher density condominium development. So it is market driven. But in this particular scenario, the proposed density does fit within our Fisher Community Plan designation. Thank you.
Can I also ask questions of the developer? I just had a question that you mentioned that it was proposed multi one bedroom and two bedroom from 400 square feet to 950 square feet, I think is what you said. Can you break that down for us? How many of those units are single residence units at the smaller level, and how many of them are prepared to be accept more family residents?
Yes, the units are ranging from 450 to 930. 66 of those are two bedroom, four of them are one bedroom.
And can I ask the landscape architect developer how you envision the aesthetic of a concrete perimeter in the neighborhood that's going to keep eyes on the street?
Generally, with the aesthetic that we have, Because the elevation of the landscape is at the second floor level. Can we change over to landscape plan? The perimeter of the walkway is going to be at the parapet, which is at the end of the actual, the edge of the actual building. And so therefore, people walking on that are naturally going to be looking over the edge of the actual building itself into the surrounding landscape or the surrounding perimeter of the building. So that generally is what is referred to as eyes on the street when it comes to stepped-head review. And since we're obviously encouraging as much pedestrian usage as possible on the perimeter, we're anticipating there is going to be a certain amount of view from the edge of the building out onto the surrounding areas on outside the actual building. And as we're encouraging people for using the amenity area in multiple different areas and multiple different spaces, we're anticipating we're going to be getting more people out into that area and viewing into the back lane area in particular, since we understand the back lane is an area of concern.
So within this proposal, knowing that trees are considered the number one component for getting people to come outdoors and enjoy their outdoors, how many trees are being proposed for this development?
I will have to read the actual landscape plan to give you a designated number, but there's actually, if I can actually do a general count. There's approximately 30 trees proposed for the on top of podium deck.
And can you tell me, are those trees of small, medium, or large size?
That's because they're actually on a podium deck, obviously we have to be considering structural stability, so they are of small growth trees.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Dan Millsip. There are no more speakers on the list.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions from council? We'll be dealing with this, as you know, later on. Councillor Vandenbroek.
Is the whole thing, entire complex, gated? Can you go back to that, the one picture where you were showing the back lane and where the parking was going to be and everything? I have huge concerns about that.
All of the parking is in the underground structure.
So there's nothing outside, everything is underground?
Correct.
And where is the entrance to the underground? Is it visible?
It is on the lane.
So it actually backs onto the lane?
Yes.
It's not on the road?
Right, and that's a requirement of engineering. That's preferred.
And where is the garbage being picked up again?
Right next to it, right beside the entrance.
So that's going to have one of those little gates where the garbage thing is going to be visible?
No, it's completely enclosed. They're solid steel doors.
So you can't even see in that it's a garbage?
No.
Okay, good. Where on this, okay, so the vehicles go in by the back lane. And your pedestrian entrance is where? On 53rd?
In the center.
And what's that going to look like? In regards to, are you going to have a front entranceway there?
Yes.
What's going to be there? And what are you going to do for security for that?
Right. There's a large two-story roof to designate the entrance, the wide stairs, as well as the accessible ramp, so all paths lead to the front door. We do not secure those. That is public access, and that's the reason why we front windows in that direction.
Okay. Now, is there going to be fob entry to the underground and the rest of the townhouses, or?
Yes, it's all fob under.
Underground as
yeah.
Well? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Storibum?
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I too have some concerns about parking and vehicular access to the site. There still will be parking allowed in front on 53rd and along the side at 201A, or am I mistaken?
in our hierarchy of road network, 53rd Avenue is designated a collector road, and it's not desirable to have parking there. As the developer pointed out, there's some additional dedication requirements and no compensation to the city by the developer along the entire 53rd Avenue frontage, but there is street parking available along 201 A Street.
Okay, thank you. So this road dedication, it's not intended for like a drop-off zone or anything like that?
No, it's intended to accommodate future road widening needs.
I understand. Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Minchuk. I'm also concerned about the size of the parking spots in the underground parking garage. It seems to me that you've got an abundance of small car spots, and it may be that this is the way that our society's going and that the size of these spots are in keeping with guidelines. But I also see what appears to be a walkway between the parking spots in the underground garage. Is it available for larger cars to be accommodated because of that walkway? Or is that even a walkway?
Right. Yes, there is additional space in the middle there that pedestrians can use. The size of the stalls does comply with the bylaw. The locations you see of small cars on the west side was done specifically to articulate the wall to allow the exterior landscaping. So that was a choice that was made to improve the exterior.
Okay, if I could, I would offer to suggest to you that when marketing this property, you advise the potential buyers that the spot that is associated with their unit is either small or large. It's surprising to me, from my perspective as a realtor, that a lot of these guys are buying the big trucks and they got no place to park them. Mm-hmm. So it would be nice if they knew beforehand.
Definitely.
If the size of the spot would accommodate their vehicle.
Yes, and we will be marking all the small cars as such.
Wonderful. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Councillor Albrecht.
Yes, thank you. Again, as chair of the Advisory Planning Commission, which does have a number of representatives from our community, this application was reviewed and approved. A few, again, items were mentioned as concerns, and I think they were addressed. It's interesting to note the variety of units. It provides a number of options for residents coming to our community. There are some unique features, the walking path, the pet area, courtyard and play. So it does meet the city's OCP and density controls. So, yeah, I just wanted to point that out. Thanks.
Thank you. Did you have one more question? Staff.
There's a city bus stop on on 53rd entrance.
So is that going to get moved or what?
No, there's still going to be a bus stop there. They'll be constructing a better pad for that bus stop.
Thank you to staff. Okay, further from council? Seeing none. I need a motion to close this public hearing.
Close.
Councillor Storteboom, Councillor Arnold, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4. So the next item is the regular council meeting, the adoption of the agenda, that the January 25th, 2016 agenda be adopted as circulated. I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Storteboom, Councillor Albrecht, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4. The minutes. I have the minutes of the January 11th, 2016 meeting be adopted as circulated. Need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Arnold, Councillor Storteboom. All those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Business arising from the public hearing, bylaw 2976, the zoning amendment for properties at 20721, 20725 Fraser Highway. A motion, third reading of the bylaw cited as a zoning bylaw 1996, number 2100, amendment number 127. 2015, number 2976. I need a mover and a seconder. So Councillor Martin, Councillor Storteboom, discussion. Anything from anybody? Nope. Okay, all those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Bylaw 2976, zoning amendment for property located at 5290 and 5308 201 A Street. Third reading of the bylaw cited as zoning bylaw 1996, number 2100, amendment number 128, 2015, number 2978. I need a mover and a seconder for this. I need a mover. Councillor Albrecht. Councillor Albrecht. Seconded by Councillor Storderbloom. Discussion. Councillor Vandenbroek.
I don't know if this is appropriate or not. I guess I probably shouldn't start off with this. I have a really hard time with these zoning changes and changing everything into these multi-residential townhouses and condos, and nothing against developers. You guys have great ideas, they're great plans. I wasn't around, I wasn't on council when this multifamily zoning went through. And one of the reasons why I did run for council was because I don't like the multi-densification that's going on in the city of Langley. And I just want to make it clear, we've had other proposals come out and other zoning bylaw changes, and I've disagreed with the majority of them. And I've had quite a few people ask me, and I think now is the appropriate time to come out and say it, that I wasn't part of the council that put this plan together, and I think we should really look at revising it. I'm sorry, but Gerald said, what, 1999? We just got stats coming out that we have one of the biggest transient population. We've had tons of new info come out, and I don't think our community is going in the right direction, and I want to throw that out there. And if other council members want to be mad at me or staff for throwing this out, so be it. I don't care. I have to get it off my chest that, and again, I'll itinerate. It's nothing against you developers and what you're building and what you're doing. I just personally do not feel that this is the right direction for the city of Langley.
Councillor Arnold.
Yeah, going back to staff, you mentioned the study that was done about the traffic and all that sort of thing. And you said that was done about a year ago?
Right.
Okay, so did it take these 70 units into consideration?
No, it wouldn't have, but the threshold for requiring a traffic impact analysis is 100 vehicles per hour. So this development wouldn't meet that criteria. And because the threshold also for vehicles per day, it's 1,500. If they're less than 1,500 vehicles per day, then the intersection is satisfactory the way it is.
So if you go by the numbers that you had at the time and then you add in this one, it still is under
right.
those amounts?
Right.
Okay.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you very much. I'm going to vote in favor of this this development. We had a nice conversation last night in my living room, going over some of the pictures, and I'm happy that you're engaged as a citizen. That certainly your right to do that, and whether we agree or disagree, it doesn't matter. You are engaged, and I appreciate that. And as you know, I live a half a block from this development that's going up. I think whether you're in favor of the multifamily designation, it's been in place for quite some time, and it's unfortunate that when you bought your home, you didn't realize that. You may not have bought there. You might have bought somewhere where you are going to set. Doesn't mean to say you have to develop your property, but certainly it might give you more comfort living in another area, knowing that it's not going to go into the multifamily. But it is designated multifamily, and to be very honest with you, I think when I started to read my agenda yesterday and came across this, it was sort of like, wow. I've never seen anything like this with all these different amenities in the courtyard and stuff like that. And again, it is going to be a multifamily, but considering what's on the corner now, I think it's going to be a big improvement to the neighborhood. So, but I do have some questions in regards to some of the amenities that you're putting in, and I was very pleased to see the dog park part of it, because so many, well, certainly the place that I live in, they don't allow pets, which today the high-end hotels are allowing pets. But this, there's two questions in regards to this. When these places are sold, there's going to be a strata council formed. And what happens if they decide they don't want any pets or dogs in there?
We can control the initial strata documents.
You can or you can't?
We can.
You can, okay.
So we will be making that allowance.
Okay, I didn't realize pets. That you could do that.
So we can at the beginning. We can't control the future amendments.
Right.
But it's hard to change them. You need a high majority of people in favor to make a change.
Especially if there's so many pet owners today. Yeah. And the other question I have in regards to the dogs, in the plan, it shows a garbage receptacle, and you've got pictures here of a waste station. So I'm assuming within your walls, you're going to provide a dog bag dispenser.
Definitely.
You're going to provide a dog waste to deposit it. Who's going to pick that up? Who's going to look after that?
The garbage pickup. It's part of the recycling program, yeah.
So the dog waste area is going to sort of be in one corner, and then in the other corner is going to be your garbage. So who's going to look after getting rid of the dog waste container, the contents of it?
Right. It's part of the strata maintenance, so they'll be taking care of it. It's actually directly below. The garbage is directly below. So you've given me an idea about...
I'm sorry?
The garbage enclosure is directly below the dog park. So we might want to look at a way...
I thought it was in the opposite corner where the parking was.
Well, unfortunately, the landscape architect oriented their drawings the other direction. So they are in the same spot.
Yeah. So these drawings are...
Yeah, so they've done north this way, and we did north.
Where is this courtyard going to be? On the corner of 53rd and 201A, or in the back?
In the back.
Okay, so that these drawings aren't quite correct, or I'm reading them wrong?
No, they're just not oriented the same way.
Okay.
North is not up the page in both cases.
Okay. So you'll have a garbage contractor that will take away dog waste?
Definitely, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Councillor Storbrum, then Councillor Arnold.
Totally.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And Points West, welcome back to the city of Langley. It's a well thought through development. I'm sure that you'll be professionally marketing it, and I look forward to your success. It's a welcome addition to our community. In keeping with the official community plan, that is no secret and has been on file with the city of Langley for a good long period of time. If the residents of the city of Langley prefer to change that plan, that is certainly available. But we've been going in this direction for a good long time now. And as a result, we have a lot of aging inventory residential houses in that area that really need to be replaced and updated with new housing inventory. I welcome this as an addition to my community, in keeping with other developments that are in immediate proximity to this particular property. And I will be supporting this proposal. And thank you again for doing business with the City of Langley. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Councillor Arnold.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Getting back to what Councillor Martin was asking about the dogs and the strata councils, when they set this up, if they set it up in such a way that pets are allowed, if the Strata Council decides to change that, that would not change it for anyone who already has a pet. They would be grandfathered. And so most Strata Councils don't decide to make that choice because there's still going to be pets there. In our building or in our complex, we're allowed pets. And in fact, at Halloween, we open up the rec room and we wait for people to come, and we get more pets with uniforms on than we do kids. So it just, in fact, I think that's one of the reasons a lot of people move into our complex is because they are pets. And nowadays, more and more people are having pets. So it's not the type of thing that the Strata Council can suddenly change like that. They could change it, but then every dog that's there at the time is going to have to die before that ever is done. Right? So,
Councillor Albrecht.
Yes, thank you. Again, I too live on 53rd, and I've got concerns over traffic, and the increase is always concerning. So I just wanted to address Mr. Lowe's concerns about traffic, the numbers, the traffic calming measures, and I just want to assure him that we'll be monitoring that process, how that looks, and if changes need to be made, we can discuss that appropriately. Regarding the density at that particular location, I think it's a nice looking site or building, and like I said before, there's a variety of options for a number of different residents and needs out there in the community. Development is supply and demand, and I think that the developer is putting that product out there. Whether we agree or not as council as to the density of that particular neighborhood is moot at this point because that's what it allows. So we need to maintain that and support that position. So I'll be voting in favor. Thank you.
Councillor Storibo.
Just one more thing, Mr. Mayor, if I may. I want to acknowledge Kelly Locha as well. Good to see you, Council. Thank you for coming out. I appreciate your concerns about traffic calming and the volumes of traffic on your front street. You've been a proponent in that neighborhood for traffic calming and reduced speeds for as long as I can remember, and probably longer. 12? 20 years. So we're happy to note that you've requested another speed hump. Whether or not that's in the plan for the next little while remains to be seen, but I just wanted you to know that it is recorded. You do have friends on council, and in the event that another speed hump is required, we'll be certainly looking at it in keeping with Councillor Albrecht's concerns. So you're a good neighbor. Thanks for looking out for the neighborhood.
Thank you, Councillor Storterboom. To Wes, this particular condominium unit is quite unique in my mind. I've never seen one with a walking area around a building like that. I've never seen one with a public amenity spot that has the concerns of the pets. This is, I believe, one of the first in Langley. I don't think I've seen one that has a dedicated spot like that. The eyes on the street. I've seen many complexes in the city, and if one is going to go in that particular place, I can't think of a better look, a better fit, a better feel for a unit. It incorporates everything that the city wants in that particular area right now. As my council colleague said, the OCP has been pretty much everything north of the Nickel-Mackel is in turn up for development. Whether those people do or do not, it's been in that OCP for many years. Everything south of the Nickel-Mackel was residential. So it was basically years drawn up as the Mason-Dixon line. To kudos to the developers that come in and put their money where their mouth is or where their 2x4s are, Kerr and Kerr, they have developed the wonderful subdivision across the street from Stafford School. I applaud them for going at great lengths and putting $1.5 million homes across the street from Stafford. You know, that developer sees the city, believes in the city, and Wes, for the company that you're dealing with, you know, they could go cheap on this. I don't think they've gone cheap. Correct me if I'm wrong. This looks like
it's a quality development.
It's a quality development, and so I wish to thank you. So I'll call the question then. All those in favor of this one, bylaw 2978. All in favor? Against? Councillor Vandenbroek is against. Thank you. The next item we have is community spotlight. And I'm going to ask Councillor Martin to go up to the mic. And tonight's community spotlight is on Pat Dawson. And Pat is in the back. She has been the library manager here for the city of Langley, and she is going to be leaving us. And Councillor Martin.
And I'm going to ask Pat to join me here, please. Okay, Pat Dawson is our library manager for the City of Langley and the Terry Fox Libraries and will retire effective March 31st, 2016 after 17 years of service to the Fraser Valley Regional Library. In the 1970s, in the heydays of career opportunities for young graduates, Pat had the good fortune to try two career paths, one in education and the second in business management. Before realizing that a career in libraries would combine the best of both education and business and add even more. Pat attended UBC, where she earned her Master's of Library Science. At her first position in New Westminster Public Library Children's Department, she developed a love of children's literature and recognized the impact that early literacy can have on a community. As the Dawson family grew, Pat decided to put her career on hold and spend a few years at home with her own children. During that time, she pursued a mini career in ESL education and then returned happily to library work with a fuller understanding of the community literacy needs. Pat's first position with the Fraser Valley Regional Library was at Maple Ridge Public Library as a public services librarian, and then as a supervisor for information services, where she assisted in the move to the new Maple Ridge facility. In 2004, Pat was appointed deputy library manager for Maple Ridge, Pitt Meadows, and Port Coquitlam. Then in 2007, she became library manager for Port Coquitlam and the city of Langley. During her career with Fraser Valley Regional Library, Pat Dawson has made a significant contributions to system-wide Fraser Valley Regional Library initiatives and committees that have provided invaluable underpinnings to the quality of service provided to the customers and staff. Pat Dawson is highly regarded by her peers for her astute insights, her wisdom, and wholehearted dedication to seeking the best for everyone and in everyone. The Fraser Valley Regional Library has been superbly served by Pat Dawson over these past 17 years, and all of us who have known her will miss her deeply. We wish her the most wonderful and fulfilling experiences as she moves into the next season of her life. On a personal note, Pat, I'd just like to add, get choked up here, as the library rep on the board for the past year, it's been a tremendous pleasure working with you. It's been a lot of fun. We've talked about your grandchildren, my grandchild, and it's really been good getting to know you. We've had discussions about different programs in the library, and you know the one I could think of is when we had our Fine Free Day. You were on board right away. Your staff and you made it a special day for the community, and those are the kind of things that, you know, we can expect from Pat, or have expected and have gotten from Pat over the past 17 years. So you are going to be missed, Pat, and I just feel like I'm getting to know you, and you have to leave. But you're going to hang around for the opening of the Tim Center. So that's the main thing. I, on behalf of City Council, would like to present you this certificate, but I'm going to read it out first. City of Langley, British Columbia, on behalf of Langley City Council, we wish to extend our heartfelt appreciation to Pat Dawson for your 17 years of devoted service to the Fraser Valley Regional Library and to our community. You have made a lasting impression as a significant contributor to the success of the Fraser Valley Regional Library programs and initiatives, both locally and system-wide. You are truly an example of the spirit that makes the City of Langley the place to be. Pat, thank you so much for all your years of service. Do you have anything to say?
I was asked if I wanted to say a few words, and I couldn't resist the opportunity. It will be my last opportunity. I brought a book and my notes because as Gail was starting to feel a little choked up, I must admit that the road to retirement is one moment ecstatic and the other moment very, very sad and very terrifying too. So forgive me, I've made some notes because otherwise I may go into that depth of sadness far too early. So I did, like I say though, I did want to take the opportunity and if you can indulge me for just a few minutes. I wanted to tell a couple of stories. But first of all, Mayor Schaefer and Councillor Martin and other councillors and city staff, I just wanted to thank you so much for the support that you have given to the library. Especially, you know, I look back over the past 2 and 3 years, and council and staff gave the library staff the opportunity to imagine what our library can be going into the future. And the impact that you had on staff by allowing us to play that part in the design and the planning of the library was very, very important. And I know that staff are going to do their very, very best in the new library. In fact, we've already met with recreation staff, and we're already planning the great things we're going to do with the Tim Center staff as well. As I mentioned, there's that road to retirement, and a great deal of my job, and I'm sure your jobs as well, has been looking forward, forecasting, predicting, guessing, estimating, trying to figure out what's ahead. But as I near retirement, I start looking back. And I want to share one story with you, which I feel, which is a story very important to me. It happened a fair number of years ago. But I was asked to deliver and to develop and deliver an early childhood literacy program. And I decided to focus on kids who are probably in situations where they are at risk not to develop their full potential in literacy skills. So I took the program to a high school where moms were at high school and needed daycare for their kids. I took the program to daycare. I took it to centers where there's new Canadians and their families, and also to centers where there's social support for members in the community. I also took the program to a transition house, and this was a house where women and their kids stayed very briefly because they had either experienced or witnessed violence in their home. And my story happened at the transition house. Usually, and I suppose very sadly, when I would go to visit the transition house, there were many mums and many kids. But I went one day, and there was just one mum and her son. He was about 4 years old. What I did at the beginning of the program is I would try to create a transition from what the kids were doing to my program, which was stories, songs, puppets. And so I asked the little boy to pick out a story, and he and his mum could read it together. So he picked out a book, and he and his mom sat on the couch, and I set up my puppets and I set up my stories, and I realized immediately that his mom could not read. She turned to me and she said, "I think he likes this one. Can we read this one first?" So the three of us sat on the couch and I read the story, and then I did my program. And at the end of the visit, the kids could pick out a book to keep for themselves. We had generous community donors who allowed us to provide every child with a book of their own. So the little boy had his book and he hugged it to his chest. I went through my things that I had brought and I found a copy of the book that the three of us had read together on the couch. So I went to his mom and I said, "Would you like to have this book?" And like her little son, she clasped it to her chest and then she hugged me and She said that she had never learned to read, but she was going to make sure that her son not only learned to read, but learned to love to read. Because it was a transition house, I've never seen the mom and the child again, but I believe that she kept her promise, and I believe that many years later now that little boy is probably reading and enjoying his reading. The library staff, we don't really see the impact of what we do, because a lot of times the encounters we have with our community residents are very short. But I know from experience that every encounter we do have, that person is enhanced in some way. And I just want council and staff to know that the stories I'm taking to retirement, and this is just one, are very great stories because of the support that you've given the City of Langley Library. So thank you for giving me my few moments, and thank you again for your great support. I brought the book I read. There's 35 copies in the Fraser Valley Regional Library. It's called Something from Nothing, 1992, so it's an old book. I would really encourage you, if there's a child in your life or just for yourself, if you request a copy from the library and just spend a couple of minutes reading this beautiful story, I guarantee you'll enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you. Pat, would you like to come up, and all the council would like to say something to you? You know, it's something else to spend all those years in the library, and for all the work that you've done, come on down. On behalf of council and the city, enjoy your retirement.
John, Pat, all the best to you. What do you plan to do with retirement? Don't tell me you're going to catch up on your reading.
I am. I am. How little we read.
Once you get started, you never
Again, enjoy retirement. Yes.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Next item we have under the mayor's report is that there's a meeting, council meeting February 1st, 2016, another one after that on February 15th, 2016. Metro Vancouver, Councillor Soderbloom, do you have anything at all?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It was my privilege to attend the Chamber of Commerce dinner meeting with my with yourself, Mr. Mayor, and Councillors Albrecht and Vandenbroek and Councillor Arnold, where we heard Greg Moore speak. He's the chair of Metro Vancouver, and he spoke to the history of the organization with regard to water, sewer, and solid waste in our region. Commencing in 1914, and he covered off some of the significant projects and the current situation and the visioning for Metro Vancouver, including a regional responsibility for air quality, which is available for residents to view at the Metro Vancouver website and the Air Map website as well. Also, Metro Vancouver is doing a water survey. As we know, there was a bit of a shortage for water this past summer, and Metro Vancouver has a survey for individuals who are concerned about water consumption in our region available at the website. And they're also looking at a campaign with regard to changing out wood-burning stoves. So if you have a wood-burning stove, it would be available through Metro Vancouver to get a rebate for a more efficient unit, maybe a different type of wood-burning stove or something completely different. And again, that information is available at the website. We haven't had any Metro meetings since our last council meeting, but the next one is scheduled for Friday. So I look forward to attending. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Are there any questions?
Off the hook.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Storteboom. Councillor Martin, Library Happenings.
Thank you very much. City of Langley Library Happenings. In September 2015, Fraser Valley Regional Library launched our newest early literacy initiative, 1,000 Stories Before Kindergarten, a program for families with babies and young children before they enter kindergarten. Research shows that early literacy activities like sharing stories build vocabulary, increase reading readiness, and encourage positive attitudes and habits around reading that stay with children as they grow. Reading 1,000 stories is a challenging but achievable goal. Regularly reading just a few stories at a time from birth to kindergarten will get a parent and their children past that goal. 3 stories a day adds up to 1,095 in a year. 10 stories a week for 2 years is 1,040. Families get a keepsake reading log where they record the books they read together. They can even record told stories. Incentives along the way keep the parents and children engaged, completion stickers for every 50 stories, and special prizes for reaching the halfway mark and for completing all 1,000 stories. Over 120 children have already signed up at our library. One little fellow recently finished reading 1,000 stories, and he came in to collect his completion prize. He was very excited to discover that he could choose a brand new book as an additional prize. He chose The Grouchy Ladybug by Eric Carle, and this was evidently one of his favorite books. So it's very easy to sign up. I did sign my granddaughter up, and nothing gives me more pleasure when she picks up a book and brings it over to me and hands it to me, and you go through it with it. So it's a great program, and it's very easy to sign up. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. And Councillor Martin will, as of February 1st, be giving us tourism happenings. So there'll be library happenings and tourism happenings. And look forward to see what's happening in the way of people coming and going and enjoying our little city of Langley City. So the next item we have is the financial plan presentation. I'm not sure if, Darren, do you have the explanatory note on this one here in front of you?
I don't have it in front of me, but it's at the
other. Okay, I'll read it out and just lead into what you're doing, or?
I'm going to cover most of that, but go ahead, Mayor.
Okay, well, I'll just read off the first part. I thought maybe you had it. The purpose of the bylaw number 2980 is to adopt the 2016 to 2020 financial plan. In 2016, our five-year financial plan includes a $43.2 million in operating expenditures and a further $10.4 million in capital expenditures. Approximately 76% of the operating expenditures are funded through property taxes and utility charges billed at the end of May each year. And I'll let you go through it and explain it all.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So Mayor Schaefer and members of council, I'd like to take this opportunity just to present, as you said, the 2016 financial plan. I'm going to focus on the capital improvement plan, capital funding sources, operating cost drivers, tax rate effects, and the next steps. As you mentioned, we have in our capital improvement plan $10.4 million in projects that are itemized. Some of the larger projects are on this slide. I'll let you just have a quick look at them. Primarily road projects relating to 56th Avenue, road rehabilitation, some park projects including Penzer Park, traffic signals. We are refurbishing our ladder fire rescue truck for $400,000, as well as some design projects. Capital projects are funded by a variety of sources. The first one that I'm going to discuss tonight is transfer to reserves. Each year, the city allocates approximately 7% of the tax and utility fees collected towards capital infrastructure renewal. We have gradually been building up this amount, in particular in the water and sewer funds, in order to undertake infrastructure replacement projects. As pipes age, they have to be replaced. This becomes particularly important for a large segment of our pipes that were installed in the 60s and 1970s, and due to our soil conditions, we know that we need to replace them in the coming years. Putting money into reserves will assist the city to address the infrastructure renewal. In the prior 3 years, the city had a specific infrastructure levy on our tax notice. Council will take a pause in replicating this approach in 2016 in order to accommodate the funding needs for the operating of our new Tim's Community Center. And I'll touch upon that a little later in my presentation. However, in 2017, staff will be recommending that we re-implement the infrastructure funding levy. Another funding source for capital improvements is the city's casino proceeds. The city receives 10% of the net proceeds of our casino each year. We have estimated that the proceeds will increase by $400,000 in 2016, bringing it to a total of $6 million. Council does allocate some of the funding towards community grants, as well as $168,000 to the enterprise fund, which allows City Council to address projects that may arise during the year after the budget has already been approved. However, the majority of the casino proceeds are used and are allocated to projects in the capital improvement plan. And that total is almost $5.4 million. As well, development cost charges generated by new construction in the city also provide funding for the capital improvement plan for projects specifically identified in the DCC bylaw. Borrowing is another opportunity that council could undertake. Council has to be mindful, though, that any borrowing that is undertaken will require interest repayments, which basically adds 60% to the cost of the project over the life of the repayment period. The city typically has adopted a pay-as-you-go approach, and currently the city of Langley is debt-free. At the end of 2015, if revenues are higher than budgeted or expenses are lower than anticipated, primarily because of vacant staff positions or lower snow removal costs due to less snow last winter, for instance, a surplus is generated. It has been the city's policy to allocate any surplus into the capital works reserve. Now switching our focus into the operating side of the budget or the financial plan. In 2016, as the mayor has said, the financial plan includes $42.3 million in operating expenditures, and over 70% of those expenditures are funded through property taxation or utility charges billed at the end of May each year. Municipalities are the only level of government that has a balanced budget. Every expenditure has to be provided in our budget so that we can't overspend or go into a deficit. So adopting a budget is a pretty significant process. The expenditure gap in 2016 is $883,305, which would require a 3.75% property tax increase to close that gap. This is including new growth revenues of $280,000. This means that during 2015, new construction of buildings like condos or commercial buildings have resulted in new taxation in 2016 based on the value of that construction. We call this new growth tax revenues. Some of the cost drivers or revenues that we want to talk about in 2016, we did have some revenue reductions. In 2015, we were less conservative on our revenue estimates, which we will continue to be in 2016. We do have a tax stabilization reserve, which we can use as a backstop if we've been too aggressive, let's say, in our revenue projections or less conservative with our expenditure allowances. We are comfortable that we will not need this in 2015, and will we have a sufficient to cover any potential shortfall that may materialize in 2016. For example, if we have a heavy snowfall in the year or building permit revenues are not sufficient. We did have some revenue reductions, as I mentioned. Each year, people can appeal their value of their property that's determined by the BC Assessment Authority. The city uses this value to apply a tax rate to determine the charges charged for property tax on the property tax notice. In 2015, the appeal process undertaken in January resulted in $179,145 less taxation revenue being generated than when we anticipated when the budget was approved in 2015. We have to make up that revenue shortfall in the following year, being 2016, to ensure that we pay for the same level of service that we had planned in 2015. The city also owns a few properties, some of them on Fraser Highway, which are slated for demolition, and we are no longer able to collect rent on those properties. As well, there's a vacant building next to the Parks Operations Center that is no longer generating revenue as well. So there has been a decrease in our property rental income. Interest income is also lower, but there is a related expenditure that is also lower in that regard because we collect interest or pay interest on our tax prepayment plan deposits, which is lower because we're near zero now with the interest rate that we have. We did have some interest or some revenue increases as well. Dog licenses are increasing $1 per dog in the city. Business licenses and building permit fees are increasing 2%. The engineering admin fees are increasing based on a historical trend. Grants in lieu from utility companies are increasing about $9,500.
Tim's rental and program revenues are anticipated to increase with the new facility, about $75,000. And the Al Anderson pool revenues are also increasing, reflecting the historical trend in the prior couple of years. Traffic fines are given to the city by the province. We anticipate an increase of about $22,000. We use traffic fines to fund three police officers and have been doing that since the program was initiated by the province in 2007. The Community Works Fund is a gas tax revenue that the federal government has initiated in 2014 and started to share with municipalities. This revenue is transferred to our reserves to fund capital projects, so it has really no effect on our tax revenues. And the MRN, Municipal Road Network, revenues from TransLink are also increasing. As I mentioned earlier, casino proceeds are increasing, as are our expenses as they relate to a transfer to reserves, so they come in and go out of our budget in that regard. In 2015, the council remuneration pay is increasing based on the Metro Vancouver median mayor salary. The city will be holding a election, as you know, in February, and this process, because it's one-time nature, has been funded by the prior year surplus, so there's no tax effect in regard to that as well. Council amended the gaming policy in 2015 in the summer and increased the amount of money going to community grants as well as the enterprise fund. So these changes will be increasing about $22,000 going to each of these expenditure sources. City staff wages make up about $12 million of our operating budget, which is supported by property tax revenues of over $25 million. A provision has been made for QP, IAFF, and management staff wage increases. It also includes an increase of $173,000 for the staffing for the new Tim's Community Center to do front reception as well as building service workers to clean and operate the new facility, which is a much larger facility than the existing one. This represents about a 0.73% of our tax revenue increase, which I mentioned earlier was about 3.75. So without this facility, the increase would be around 3%. Policing is our largest department in the city, city's budget, which is about $11 million. It is 45% of the tax revenues collected. It's the biggest piece of the budget pie. We have 51.35 RCMP members in our contract strength, and this is an increase of one member in 2016. The city's share of the integrated teams is based on 75% of the five-year rolling average crime rate and 25% on population. Comparatively, the city has a rather high crime rate, so our proportionate share is high for a city our size. We also share with the RCMP contract costs with the Township of Langley, again using the integrated team formula. In the current year, we allowed for six vacancies. A vacancy is caused when a member who may be on sick leave or parental leave. Historically, the total police budget isn't fully expended, so under council policy, the excess is transferred to the future police cost reserve. And that's just a breakdown of our policing costs. Historically, the actual cost, contract cost is increasing $365,000. Most of this increase is relating to 2.5% increase in wages and the pension benefit costs. The city also shares a cost for the municipal employees working at the detachment with the Township of Langley. And that sharing is based on 75% of the number of RCMP members using that same 75% crime statistic and 25% population, and then 25% based on the assessed values between the two municipalities. In 2016, the Development Services Department has requested an additional plan checker or building inspector, which will be hired halfway through 2016, resulting in only half the salary of the position in the first year. But we have to let council know that the other half of that position will have to be added in 2017. In the Parks Department, there's a proposal to increase the amount of money allocated towards trail and sports field maintenance. This increase is about $67,000. The Fraser Valley Regional Library levy is increasing 2.7% or $33,000. This is to allow for 2% more books and materials being purchased in our library, and it includes staff savings due to the introduction of the book sorting machine. In 2016, the garbage fees are proposed to remain flat at $180 per household. This includes an inflationary increase in the contract, but is offset by a short-term incentive decrease in the tipping fees. We know Metro Vancouver is trying to encourage haulers to keep their waste in the region, and we understand that that tipping fee will increase again in 2017, so the propose that we keep our fees the same. If the tipping fee didn't decrease, we would be increasing our fee by $3 per household. Each year, city staff reviews their budgets and tries to trim between 1 to 5%, and we make different proposals in that regard. Over the years, $1.1 million in savings and other revenue increases have kept property tax levels lower by about almost 5%. This is an ongoing process, but as we continue, it's harder and harder to trim our budgets to continue to allow for wage increases, but also contracted services and supplies are increasing and not being reflected in our budget as it is currently. As many of the decreases identified involve staff, reducing staffing and services, we would ask, so what does all this mean as far as taxation? Tonight we'll be discussing a portion of our property tax account that the city controls. That's about 62% of what's shown on the property tax notice. School taxes, TransLink, and Metro Vancouver taxes are also shown on our property tax notice, but they're not directly controlled by the Langley City Council. Council is trying to slowly shift the tax burden to business properties, getting closer to the Metro average where the ratio is for every $1 that we collect in residential, $3 is collected in a business properties. That's the Metro average. In the city of Langley, if these proposed tax rates were adopted, the business class would be paying about $2.48 for every $1 residential, so still below the Metro average, and light industrial properties, $2.75 for every $1 residential. What this means for the average strata dwelling that I have on the screen, about 63% of our residential housing stock is made up of stratas, and they will see their city property taxes actually decrease by 2.37%, or a decrease of $29 per year. Single family homes on the other side will be increasing by $89, or 3.17%. There is only one rate that City Council can apply to all residential properties, so we can't differentiate between strata units and single family homes. The assessed value of single family homes is climbing faster than the strata dwellings, causing the difference in the tax rate effect. Business and light industrial properties are increasing on an average 4.8%. And this is the average single family home increase where I mentioned about $89 or 3.17%. $2,882 would be the average single family home for city services in 2016. If we break that down on a monthly basis, it works out to about $240. You can see the split between the various city services on the slide. It's pretty tough to, for instance, we take care of all the parks in the city for $10 a year for the average single family residential home. I know my own home, it's pretty hard to take care of my own lawn for $10 a year, so I think we're doing okay in that regard. So next steps. We did advertise the budget in the January 14th and 21st new editions of the newspaper. If there is first and second reading in front of you tonight, there will be a public input opportunity at our open house at Douglas Rec Center on Wednesday, January 27th, between 6 o'clock and 7:30. City staff will be available to answer any questions the public will have in an informal setting. Then at the next council meeting on February 1st, we will be having a committee of the whole where the public will be invited to share their views about the city's budget, and its possible adoption could happen on later that night for third reading. And then the final adoption being the earliest proposed would be February 15th. I just want to take this opportunity to thank my staff, particularly Mr. Graham Flack, for his efforts and their efforts to put together our 2016 financial plan. And at that point, that'll conclude my presentation, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Questions? Any? Well, I'll start it off. It is under the policing with our new ratio. The city of Langley will have one officer for every 506 residents, And that does not include the reserve officers that the city also have that walk the downtown beat. I'd like to see, you know, interest, not on yourself. I'd be interested to see what the ratio is to other communities in the province, whether it's 1 to 1,200, 1 to 800, 1 to 700. I know the city of Langley is probably the lowest in the province on the ratio. And when we talk about policing, there was an old colleague that Councillor Martin and Councillor Arnold worked with here at the table, and Weir said the moth is attracted by the flame. So the city of Langley being a central location, a lot of people come into this community from outside the area, and that does cause issues. So, you know, for the city of Langley, we're paying for outside visitors. So that's one of the key things I think that you've worked on in this budget, and I'm very pleased with you and your staff. Another item, I might have missed it, but under our public safety committee, that there's going to be funding going in there. I believe we're putting $20,000 into the public safety committee, and if need be, they could draw some more from the enterprise fund. So we are working on public safety. People have asked me on the casino in the community, why don't you just lower our taxes by using casino funds? Well, actually, 1.3%, the property taxes would be higher by 1.3% this year if the casino wasn't here. So what we are, in a roundabout way, the casino definitely helps the taxpayer out there, because over the years, I believe it's over 25.5% your taxes would be higher if we did the overpasses, the streets, the infrastructure improvement, the parks, the Tim's Community Center, all those other projects that we worked on. Your taxes would be higher by over 25.5%.
That's correct. 25.84%.
25.84%. So the projects that we've done, and to keep the city debt-free. You know, we're very pleased to have a great financial team and yourself and your staff that, you know, look out for the city. And you know, it's very important to be debt-free. We're living within our means. And I know this, you know, we as a council look at the bottom line. We try to be very aware of the needs of the community, and aware of, where funding comes from for the people that live in this community. You know, and again, you know, it's to your staff. Many hours go into making this budget work. And, again, thank you, Darren. And anything else?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Mr. Late, to you and your team for pulling together another very efficient and practical and affordable budget. I just want to let folks know that Council spent a good deal of time working with you and your team to put together this budget. And I believe this is the second or the third year in a row that property taxes are down for multifamily residential.
Second year.
Very good. Yeah, and that's almost unheard of, property taxes going down. So it's certainly something noteworthy. Yes, single family detached homes have gone up in value, and I don't hear anybody complaining about that, even though there's always going to be somebody complaining that the property taxes are going up. A lot of the 0.73 percent of 1% is because of staffing requirements for our new Tim's Community Center. So I would invite those who would to come and investigate that when it opens up, to be sure that you're getting your money's worth. But for the rest of it, I think that staff continues to do an excellent job, and I just wanted to congratulate you and thank you very much for your report.
Thank you. And seeing nothing else, Councillor Vandenbroek.
I feel like I need to say something for Councillor Hall sitting here, something really negative, but I won't. I know he would have said something. Sorry, I just lost my train of thought on that. Totally lost my train of thought. I guess it doesn't matter. Don't worry about it.
Councillor Hall would have lost his train of thought, too, then, you know.
I know.
You know, it's... he would
have note writing.
Yeah, he would have been so excited, you know. At,
I know.
So.
Together.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Light, for your report. And I just wanted to really reinforce that by law, we can't run a deficit budget. We have to have a balanced budget. That's really important to note. And $240 a month, there's some people spending that much on internet and cable TV, I believe. So I think we're getting a smoking deal there. And I really wanted to make sure that I thank staff for their pursuit of provincial and federal funding. That's really helped us get some projects and some rejuvenation in for our infrastructure, and we still need to keep pursuing those revenue sources. So I look forward to working with staff on gaining more and more dollars from our provincial or federal or government partners. Thank you.
You had an epiphany. Go ahead.
Any. In regards to strata versus multifamily housing, there was a decrease and an increase. Is there any way we can change that or have staff looked into that?
Yeah, so there's only one rate under the provincial community charter that city council can set for residential properties. So we can't differentiate between strata properties and single family homes. We can only apply one rate. And so what happens with the BC Assessment Authority is those properties are going up, strata properties, which is the majority of our housing stock, is going up at a lower rate than the single family homes, and therefore we can only apply one rate.
So then it would be better to build single family homes than just saying.
Thank you. So I need a mover and a seconder now. Councillor Martin, Councillor Albrecht. Great. You got it?
I got it in.
Okay, all those in favor? Against? It's, oh.
You talking about the budget?
Yeah. You for or against? For or again?
I'm going to go against right now.
Against, okay. Yes. Okay. So, again, thank you to the staff for putting this together, and it's nice to see the RCMP officer coming on board. The last item I may have here is the request to canvass on behalf of World Vision. That's on February 1st to the 6th and the 15th to the 20th. I need a mover and a seconder for canvassing door-to-door for World Vision.
I'll move it.
Councillor Storbroom, Councillor Vandenbroek, all those in favor? It's against, it's unanimous for. And the last one is some information, and it's the BC Aware Days campaign, privacy and security awareness. So, anything else? That's it. And move to adjourn, yeah. Councillor Martin, Councillor Storderbroom, all those in favor?
Aye, aye.
Aye, aye.
Happy birthday, Mr. Mayor.